Okay,
And
let me let the public in. And let me get the agenda. And let me try to move it elsewhere. Come on. Where did it go? Oh, there we go. Come on. Oh, technical difficulties. Here we go.
Media is zoomed.
There we go. Okay, so there's that. And let me share the screen. And wow, so slow. Okay.
There you go.
Okay. Terrific.
Okay, there we now. Now we know what we have to do. We'll do a call to order. So we've done that, and Susan, if you would please call the roll.
Sure. Mr. Agnese?
Present.
Mr. Macchio?
Mark, you're muted.
Oh, I think he's muted, yeah.
Sorry
I
here.
know he's there. There he is. Mr. Mortimer?
Present.
Mr. Zaharides.
Present.
I know he's there too.
Present.
There we go. Chairman Quish.
And I am also present.
And I know we have David Silkis and Stephen Harris.
So just a little confusion background. We had more interest in becoming members of the subcommittee than would have been permitted because if we end up with a quorum, it becomes a meeting that requires notice. So we planned on having more than we could have. So we decided to call it a special meeting. And therefore, then everyone could join in that wanted to. The concern came if we didn't have a quorum in a special meeting, we couldn't actually conduct business. So we reverted back to the regulation subcommittee format. And that's why we had that confusion to begin with. We'll probably have this on more than one occasion because we want to make sure it's inclusive for everyone who wants to participate to be able to. But we're going to need people to, let us know as soon as possible if they can attend or not attend, so we'll know in advance whether to call it a special meeting via Zoom or regulation subcommittee. But anyway, we'll take that under advisement on each meeting as it comes. We do have somebody with a microphone on that's creating background noise.
Oh, it might be me. Let me fix it.
Thank you, Susan. Okay. So we our topics for discussion are discussing continuing the discussion of requiring all multifamily developments to have some affordability as a component throughout the whole city, not specific to any particular zone. And then we would look at a couple of things to frame that, whether it would be maybe a threshold, like if you were doing a five family or a four family, maybe that's exempted. So some kind of a criteria that this regulation would kick in, 10 or more units, 8 or more units, whatever we decide. And then if we wanted to have a tiered system, like a minimum of 10% plus one unit, so at least we're making a little headway. And then if somebody was willing to do 15%, give them a carrot somehow. And so those are some thoughts I had to start with. We do have Stephen Harris here who has chosen to join us. So Stephen, if you don't mind, I'd appreciate you just introducing yourself to board members that are new and then weighing in on your thoughts regarding affordability and the mandate that we're discussing.
Sure. Stephen Harris, I've been with Milford now. I'm the CEO. I've been with Milford for 12 years, going on 13 years. Before that, I worked in the city of New Haven, same, more or less the same capacity. I've been in planning and zoning altogether since 1996.
So that CEO is zoning enforcement officer.
Yep.
For those who don't know. What's your instinct here, Stephen?
There's different ways to skin the affordability cap. Tax credits are one avenue. One thing I don't think we can do is mandate someone provide an affordable unit. You can give them some density bonuses. You can give them other height bonuses or something along that line. Reduce the parking, some incentive to reduce cost in some other area, which would offset the cost of the affordable unit. I know New Haven does it all the time. New Haven arm twists people because people want to build in New Haven. They want to build lots of big apartment buildings. So New Haven sort of does what New Haven does. And there's always some sort of incentive. So they make it financially viable for developers with larger projects to come in and provide affordable housing because they have the economy of scale to do it. With small developments like 3, 4, 5, 6 units, I'm not an expert in how much it costs to build, but it's rare outside of an 830G to see those sorts of incentives in small projects. I also don't think you can legally mandate someone build an affordable unit. I don't think that.
Okay. I appreciate that perspective. There are cities and towns that put a requirement in. And the legality, I think that we're gonna move forward with a belief that is legal, that we can do it. We are a legislative branch at this juncture for this type of thing. And if down the road it's challenged, and if down the road somebody finds out that we can't do it, the state, the whole nation knows that there is a housing crisis, or whatever word you want to use, a situation where affordability is impacting so many people's lives that and I believe other towns are doing it. And so we're not going to go on the assumption that it's not legal. We're going to go on the assumption that it is legal but we'll also try to make it viable. And that's what I hope that we're going to do here in this committee and then in the full board, is to make it viable, you know, find a legitimate carrot to permit builders to, you know, make a buck. I mean, that's what they do. I think what we have in our favor is that Milford's desirable. It seems that there are a number of developers that want to develop here, and some are using 830G, some are doing whatever they do and doing market rate. But there is, you know, whatever Milford has. It's a transportation center. It's got the beach. It's, you know, local to New York, Boston, you know, all over. Whatever the good things are, that if we challenge the maximum that a developer can make just marginally with some affordability, we can help change the culture that now is exclusionary. So our goal is to find that sweet spot. And, you know, we talked about 10%. I know that other towns have done 10%, and I think 10% plus one unit, just so that we're making headway. I think there's a couple things that are important to consider. One, we're legitimately concerned about affordability. Whether we call it a crisis or not, might not be the best language, but we want to provide housing options and promote that. And we also want to curtail eventually 830G from changing neighborhoods in a way that the neighbors that live there and have for decades don't object to. So if we can get some affordability. If we can show progress, we may be able to get another moratorium, or if we get creative with our zone change, our potential to change zones, we may get out of that 10%, and maybe the state will maybe start counting some of the federal housing and things like that that'll help us down the road. But I'd like to open it up to the members, and still Stephen and David, you know, weigh in with your thoughts and informally just speak up, speak your mind, please.
Well, I'd like to, you sort of set up a nice segue into something the legislature just did, which we're all trying to figure out what's going on. But it appears when the legislature finished business last week that they may have changed the formula on what can be counted towards a moratorium.
Oh, good.
So they are now including what's called middle housing, which on its surface would allow the city to count two-family, three-family, and other multifamily housing units towards a moratorium, as long as those housing units were developed as of right. But so that's, yeah, everyone's trying to figure out, because the way that the legislature wrote everything is basically leaving every legal mind scratching their heads, but that seems to be the intent.
Okay, so is if you would please forward us, you know, capture that somewhere and forward it to us all, including all members, not just the committee. So your first pass at understanding it is that all twos, threes, and fours are automatically counted.
They, if they meet certain requirements, which appear to be that they were, among other things, legal at the time that they were created. They met the zoning at the time they were created. And there was something else in there. And that they're done as of right. So that's if we're interpreting it correctly, that would be very interesting, because, you know, then we can run a filter through the assessor's office to look at those units, and, you know, they would have just for background, when we establish when we were able to create a moratorium for 830G, that is based on a point system that assigns a certain number of points to units that are affordable in a complex, in an affordable complex, and units that aren't affordable. But if they're in an affordable, you know, an 830G complex, they have a certain point value. It appears from this that units that are not in an 830G project would have a certain point value, which could then be counted towards a moratorium. And the way that it has worked up to now is you can't reuse points that you've used for a previous moratorium, and I think that's still the case. So, you know, I've talked to, you know, briefly with the city attorney and some other, you know, attorneys, and everyone's trying to figure this out. So
it was a pass. So it passed the legislature. Is there an effective date, or is it effective?
Oh yeah, everything is effective October of 2024.
The affordability. How do they track that? I mean, is this a lease thing, or I mean,
good questions, because the legislation doesn't talk about types of ownership, and that's something that I just want to touch base on. We can't get into types of ownership for land use anyway, so it's land use types. So again the legislature in this case talks about a two family, a three family, or a multifamily, whether or not they're leased, whether or not they're owned, whatever the story is, it's the dwelling type. So On its surface, it looks like there may be more things that we could count towards a moratorium. Having said that, you know, we should still obviously continue to look at ways to create more opportunity for affordable housing of one kind or another. So I would still continue down the path that you want to continue. Yeah,
no, that's it. I think that's great. And I think that we were looking at this as a, you know, a multi-prong issue to deal with. And so if we need less focus on truncating 830G, we're probably not going to get to the 10%, but so we'll probably still need to do it. We might, though, who knows? But anyway, I think that the conversation, I think, is still legitimate in that there is an outcry through the community and an opportunity for us to help create more housing options for different price points on the rent, which I think is a good thing.
Yeah.
In general. So yeah, pop in anytime. I think one of the questions is, if we were to do something on a citywide thing, is 10% a good number? Should we do 10%, you know, after 10 units, after 15 units, or some kind of a lower level threshold? What's the instinct here from the team here?
I think 10 is a good starting point.
I personally do not agree with having a mandatory minimum, something along these lines. It's not going to put a dent in the affordability issue, and ultimately you're going to make these projects less financially feasible, and you're going to be stuck with that.
I think the counter to that is we need to give the carrots, and we can kind of work around the edges a little bit. I was looking at the 55 and older regulations. And for instance, this is a small thing, but the square footage for 55 and older is larger than the square footage for subdivision apartments. So if we lowered the minimums for 55 and older, maybe they could build more units, you know, to include that affordable one, things like that.
So John,
but I'm just saying we could work around the edges to try to get somewhere as well.
Hey John, I have a question for you. When whatever it was you were looking at, are you talking about the unit size or the amount of land?
Unit
okay.
size.
Okay. Okay. So one of the things that's on our radar is that we actually have to remove from our regulations anything that refers to minimum unit size, because the legislature told us we can't have that anymore.
Oh, okay. Well, that kills that idea.
Sorry.
The new minimum size is the minimum allowed by the building code.
Which is, Stephen?
I've been told by the building inspector it's 70 square feet per room, excluding the kitchen.
70
square feet?
70 square feet per room, excluding the kitchen.
Room.
So you could have a three-room apartment at 210 square feet.
Yeah, basically you can build a tiny house if you want.
Yeah, tiny
so that's lower. Home. That's lower than it's 450. That's in the regs right now for 55 and older.
Yeah,
we have. Yeah, we have, for this meeting, I was looking at, Jim and I had talked about, some of the CDD zones, and I was looking at the CDD1, which allows housing, and, in that zone, there are minimum unit sizes, there's minimum land sizes that are tied to the number of units, and since the plan of conservation of development and this body's discussions have often talked about looking at the CDD zones to promote housing. I think that is sort of a ripe you know, area to, you know, update the regulations, get rid of the minimums, have, you know, an affordability carrot. And, you know, we can look at, you know, for instance, Jim, I think it's Fairfield has a 10% minimum, and I believe that it starts at 20 units and above. Whether or not that's what we want to do, I'm just throwing it out there that that's something that you know, Fairfield has, and I guess has worked for them because they've got some rather large residential developments that have gone in along you know, the rail at the railroad tracks, the station.
Oh, well, yeah, that's a pretty big development there.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, that may be something we want to look at, that, oh, gee, in a CDD zone, you know, as of right, you can do, you know, housing of whatever type, however we want to define it. And oh, by the way, if you add 10% affordable, you know, you can go up, you know, an extra floor or two, because, I mean, all the CDDs are on main thoroughfares where, you know, having more density, having more height, would, you know, probably be a good thing, and things probably wouldn't get more than five or six stories if we allowed it, just because the cost of construction for the type of construction that's needed past, you know, five or six stories, you know, just becomes, you know, much, much greater than, you know, something that's lower. So again, food for thought.
Yeah, no, I think those are some good points. John, what is your objection to going a citywide, call it 10%, just for the sake of argument? You feel that the developers won't build housing because it won't pencil out with 90% market and 10% affordable?
Potentially. I'm just not a fan of the one size fits all attitude with mandating it for the entire city for a particular class of housing. I just think we need to get a bit more granular than that if we're going to go that route. In general, I'm not a fan of mandating specific minimums in that way.
Right.
If you do that, also, you're going to increase the housing throughout all of Milford, because then everything's going to have to, the 10% needs to be adjusted. So their 90% has to be adjusted for what they're losing for the 10%, which makes all the property values go up, which makes it even more unaffordable to come into Milford. So, yeah, I don't
think that's our challenge. If we could make it feasible economically for them to do this, we would have to make it, you know.
Yeah, but you're making single family houses go up more, because the 90% is going to appraise the next house higher, because they have to offset their 10% higher, which makes everybody else's houses go up, because they're appraising this condo for 300,000. So my house is worth 500, because they had to go up the 10% to, or they had to go up a little bit to make the profit on the 10% that they're losing, or they're losing on the 10%, I should say.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand. Let me try to say it a different way. Let me know if I captured what you're saying. You're saying that if somebody builds a 90 affordable and a 10, 90 market rate, 10 affordable, the neighboring properties are going to go up in value, and that means their taxes are going to go up?
The 90% needs to offset the 10%, meaning the 90 regular houses that you build at 90% that is market value needs to offset the stuff that they're losing on the 10%, which makes single family houses in that area, if you do a one fit all thing, go up.
Yeah, but we're not talking about single families. We're not talking about single families. We're talking about multifamilies.
I get that, but you're making that regulation or suggestion would make Milford more unaffordable, because my house that's sitting next to a condo that has 10% affordable housing, instead of it being 150,000 for a condo like they used to be, they have to be 200,000. The 90% needs to be 200,000. The affordable housing, nobody can touch anyway. So now the affordable housing is 200, the 90% condos are 200,000, which makes my house go up another 50,000, 100,000, because I have a house with property. So you're actually making everything in the town go up by making a flat 10%.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. I wonder what would actually move the needle. If we had 2,000 new units, it would probably move the needle. If we had 200, I don't think it would move the needle, you know, in terms of property values. And I don't know that anybody in the town would say, I want my property values to stay the same or go down. I think everybody that owns property in Milford would say, hey, I hope my property does go up. It builds wealth for me because I have a capacity to leverage that and use it. If you're telling me my $400,000 house is not worth $500,000, I got $100,000 more equity than I did yesterday. So that's building
wealth. I'm not arguing with that. I mean, that's not helping out the new generation that's trying to buy houses. People already have it. That's not making anything more affordable.
You're
offsetting the prices to the other people.
Yeah,
and then what making people new family houses.
What it does, though, Mark, is if at the end of the day it adds 100 units of affordable, those are 100 units that are affordable that don't exist today. If a year from now there's 100 more units of affordable, even if 900 units are increasing value to the neighborhood, it's still 100 more affordable units. So I don't buy that argument personally, but you know,
Mark's point is that those affordable units are going to drive up the cost of the market rate units. So you're adding 200 affordable units, but then everything else is becoming less affordable in proportion.
Yeah, I get that, but I can see that within the development. But I think if you have an apartment complex or multi-family units in an area, it's not going to matter how many are affordable. They're just there, and that's going to affect the market value of the houses in the neighborhood. No, you know, whether they're affordable or not, I don't think will make much of an impact outside of the development itself, which, you know, if you have 90 units that are market rate, you should be making pretty good money, and that 10% is not really going to hurt that much, especially if we give a carrot. It's all about the carrot.
Yeah, no, that's a good idea. The carrot's important. I also think that I don't think it's a static thing. It's not in stone that if you build 50 units that you're going to make X amount of money. If you want to come into Milford, you want to be part of this growing best 50 in the country cities, you have to live within these rules. And if you think you're going to make, say, $5 million on a project and you only make $4,625,000, if it's not good enough for you, there's going to be another developer that will come in, and the market will bear what market rate is. If market rate here is now $5,000 for a 2-bedroom, people are going to live somewhere else. So the developer, you know, the whole concept of the market decides what things are worth. If in fact they price themselves out, then they've made a mistake. If we're here defending a small group of developers and making the maximum profit that they are capable of under the present circumstance, then I think we're missing the boat. I think we're missing the boat because we have 50,000 people that live here, and we have, you know, a handful of people that are, and I don't mind a businessman making money, but I just am not going to stick my heels in the sand to say that this handful of people needs to make that extra 6 or 8% on a development, because to the detriment of affordability for your kids, your parents, my parents, you know, our families, or new people coming into town that want to be, support this and work and live here. So I'm just really passionate that there's a way. And I think John Mortimer has an idea, and we've all talked about, you know, the carrots, whether it's, you know, a certain size and, you know, maybe 20 units and above is it, but what's the carrot that does maybe not make them whole, in terms of exactly the same amount of money they'd make if they built 50 units all market rate, or if they had 10% affordable. To me, that delta is, I think we can mitigate some of it, and I don't think it's our responsibility to mitigate all of it. I think that Milford is solid enough economically and desirability that the developers will say, hey, you know what? I thought I could make X. Now I can make 92% of X, and I'm still happy to build here. So I think that our job is not to defend the profitability of a given development.
Nobody was defending the profitability of the developer. I was just saying that you're making single family houses less affordable by making a single policy across the board.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know that it's going to affect single family houses. It might, and I could be wrong. I just think that there's not a single voter out there that's going to vote against higher property values for their own property.
I think we're losing sight of why this conversation came about. And the reason is 830G.
That's one reason, Mark, not the only reason.
I think that's, Jim, we didn't talk about this until 830G got reinstated again. I just want to be honest. People don't like seeing a single family neighborhood, somebody, one of these developers, buy a piece of property. It's happening all over town and putting in 13 or 15 or 20 units because they call it affordable. And I think that's what started this conversation. Nothing to do about affordability, nothing to do about how much someone's going to make. It's about how do we get to the 10% so we stop 830G. I think was the reason why this conversation started to begin with. And I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that that's what the focus was. How do we, and that's why we said the only way to do that, Jim, is to get the numbers of affordable from 5% where we are today to 10%. So these affordable developers can't just start wedging these little tiny communities in single family neighborhoods. I believe that's why we started this conversation, not necessarily about actually creating affordable housing.
Yeah. Well, no, you know, I think you make a good point. And I think as we've gone down this road, I think, you know, the society in general, the activists in Milford have pointed out that there is there's another need, and that we can maybe, in our best effort, mitigate both. One is make sure that we protect the integrity of these single family neighborhoods so that we don't have multifamilies shoehorned in because of 830G. But I think it's also that we have housing options for either our existing, the development of our existing citizenry, whether it's getting older or people trying to get their first home or get their first apartment. You know, these things are economic realities that we have an opportunity to make better. And I think that's worthy work. And so I think there's more than one goal. And I think that we should be at our best finding solutions that approach a better situation for each. And it could be a few different ways to do it. One is a broad stroke at 10% or 8% or 5%. And I know John said he's not a fan of that. And that's part of the discussion. And at the end of the day, it's all going to be a vote, and the vote goes the way votes go. Another way is that David already spoke about was, that we should revisit these other zones. Primarily, a good start is the CDD zones and some exclude housing. And if we include housing there and put a requirement in those zones, so now Milford becomes a fertile field for developers that they didn't have. We're opening up, you know, potential tens of thousands of units if we go to all CDD zones. Not that there's a need for that or that there's an appetite for the builders, but if we open that up, we give them some height carrots and that will then help it pencil. And I don't think it really connects too much with the neighborhood in general, because it is, you know, Naugatuck Ave is kind of mixed residential. Devon is, you know, still some residential on the Post Road, but primarily the CDD zones are like the Post Road and downtown and New Haven Ave and places that we would really probably, you know, in a 10-year horizon, love to see beautiful apartments and, you know, nice housing and more people, you know, going to the store and the restaurants and buying their shoes or whatever, you know. So, I mean, that's, you know, the global brushstroke is not the only thing. And if it's, you know, if it's not the first thing we approach, you know, maybe we go somewhere else. I think it's viable and valuable to, you know, make a statement that we are doing something for the community and not the, you know, but it's not the only thing. So, you know, at one point we will bring forth some recommendations to the full board and we'll see, and we'll have public hearings and we'll see what the public and the developers have to say. And then we'll also hear what the public has to say and then we'll vote on it. So, I'd like to come out of here with a broad brush, but if we don't, that's fine. And we can go in and move on to discuss opportunities in CDD zones that I think David has, and possibly Steven as well, have some insights and recommendations on how we can try to solve more than one of these issues with a couple changes to those zones.
Before we get into the CDD, I think CDD definitely is an area. I think we should also look at industrial and light industrial areas for worker accommodations there. I think that's another area where we could really build a lot of apartments and have a good percentage of them affordable. I don't know if we'll ever make 10%, but I think that's where we'd need to focus.
Industrial, where?
I mean, you know, there's some, you know, ideas for co-housing and one of the things that one of the developers brought up too is these, you know, sort of tiny home communities that have, you know, co-housing. There's potential for having stuff like that be 100% affordable and having it be nice and have it be livable. And I think we don't need to mandate it and we don't need to develop it, but we need to at least open the opportunity for, and I think it's pretty much density, right, David and Steven? If, you know, we give them density one way or another. We can, you know, smaller units obviously is now mandated that we don't restrict, but, you know, whether it's height, whether it's setbacks or something.
In my opinion, density makes the mixed use zones that are basically the CDD zones more attractive to developers. If we tweak those regulations to include more housing, better housing, then with more people, more business would come in and they sort of feed off each other. Where like downtown is feeding off each other now with the new housing by the train station. I'm sure all the businesses love it. They must be making much more money because they have that large customer base right there. So you take that idea and you spread that along the Post Road, Bridgeport Avenue, and Naugatuck, and you just let nature take its course. Just make the regulations work better to foster that.
And is that primarily, like on Naugatuck anyway, there's no setbacks. You know, you could have buildings touching each other. So on that CDD. So you're really just talking about the only way to give them more more density is height.
Yeah.
And then parking.
Yeah. And you know, for instance, the CDD 2 has right now limits as to the type of housing you can go in that's tied to the amount of land and the type of units. Actually, you're going to be hearing request for a regulation change. I think it's going to be next month to tweak that zone to have it at least match downtown. which says that, you know, if you want to have more than six bedrooms, you need to ask the board for a site plan, because that's how the downtown regulation is written.
If
one of the things that the legislature is really trying to promote is, yeah, doing things as easy as possible. We come up with whatever standards you want to come up with. And, you know, is it a site plan review, or is it simply, hey, you've met the regulations, go get your permit? You want to make the development, you know, as predictable and as easy as possible with whatever densities that, you know, the board decides they want to have for a particular area. And don't forget the simple economics. The more housing you have, ultimately, the less expensive it'll be. It's supply and demand. Time and time again, places that have an abundance of housing have the least expensive housing prices and cost. Connecticut, unfortunately for Connecticut, you know, we don't have enough housing for all the people who live here, want to be here, want to stay here. So because there's a shortage, everything is more expensive. So, you know, the very first step, and I think, you know, this committee seems to be moving in that direction. Gee, let's create opportunities to create more housing, more dense housing, different types of housing. So ultimately, the cost of housing will hopefully come down, and we'll be able to accommodate all of those groups of people that, you know, I've heard throughout this evening, we want to accommodate, you know, people who want to downsize, people who want to move in and work for, you know, a company here in Milford. I mean, that's a huge problem in Connecticut, you know, of employers relocating. It's like, where can they get their employees? You know, the subway site, which is now going to be Wusthof Knives, you know, they're relocating from Norwalk. You know, why are they even staying here? Well, Milford in this area is less expensive than Norwalk. So that works out well for their employees. But, you know, if they were, you know, out of state, it's, you know, they wouldn't be looking to relocate in Connecticut because, you know, housing is so expensive. So whatever we can do to create more density and make housing more affordable in the long run is going to help everybody. So how we do that, that's what we have to work on.
that's a special sauce there.
Yep.
So if we look at, we have what, four CDD zones?
We have five CDD zones, actually. And it's, yeah, because it's a CDD 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's not counting downtown. That's the MCDD. So I don't even want to touch that yet.
I think there's some people that would like to make it a historic district, but we're not going to address that tonight. So we have some zones that permit housing, and we have different regulations for those that do and some that prohibit it. So I think the best way to do it, and the simplest way, is to come up with a set of criteria,
yep,
that will offer the carrot, mandate affordability, and those zones, we're given height, we're given parking, and we're going to exact a minimum of 10%, and anything over 70 units, 12% or something, that we can leave as a floater until the whole board listens to the developers and then the public and come up with either an add or a deduct or whatever, change it. Based on the will, a combination of the will of the people and the best thoughts of the board. But if we could have language that would either create new language in the zones that don't allow housing and make it consistent throughout all the zones, so it will replace some language in zones that currently permit housing,
right,
and it will institute language that in those zones that don't allow anything, any housing, so that it's one set across all CDD zones,
yep,
for a matter of simplicity.
Yep.
And the question then would be, do we require mixed use, or do we promote mixed use with another carrot. I mean, Stephen, you've seen it throughout different areas of town. I know down in Walnut Beach, the mixed use really didn't work, you know, with that 1960s or, you know, development, and it ended up getting demolished and putting more housing in. But now it's a little bit more vibrant. There is some mixed use there. I know Milford Center has all of the first floor, street level anyway, we'll call it. Street frontage needs to be non-residential. Do we replicate that from Milford Center, or do we have it a smaller proportion, that maybe 50% or not at all? What's your instinct?
Mixed use tends to work best at a finer scale, rather than having a large apartment house at a large apartment house, and then across the street maybe a shopping plaza. You're talking about lots of distance that people have to go. They have to cross their apartment building, cross a big street. It's hostile to pedestrian traffic. So fine grain, I'm going to trot out Europe again, but Europe has density. It's not rocket science. It's fine grain. They have commercial on the first floor. They have residential above. What they don't have is big buildings with large setbacks with 5 acres of parking in front. You want people to move up and down the street on their feet. They'll tend to spend more money. Businesses get a lot more walkthrough. Because businesses have to rely on everybody driving there. They don't make as much money. So when you talk about mixed use, it's the type of mixed use, not just mixed use per se. So you have to push the buildings up to the street, okay? And then you have to allow for several floors, where you can have your commercial on the bottom, your residential on the top. Mixed use works well that way. Walk around the village in New York City. It's fine. Right?
So let's take a strip mall on the Post Road near Ford Street. Behind it is the DPW. There's maybe, I don't know, 180, 200 feet, maybe 8 stores, 1 story. Take that. You come up with an application for parking in the back, or maybe one access down and out in front for retail, parking underneath or in back, and go up 4 stories. That's probably a viable project for the guy who owns it and has 6 rents at $1,200 each.
You have to keep in mind that it's a long-term project for a road like Boston Post Road, which is so auto-centric. It's not going to change overnight. What Milford can do is set the table for dense mixed-use development.
One of the things that we have to be cognizant of, and may have occurred last week because it was a high priority item, but I don't know that it passed, was the legislature was going to make it very easy for us. They were going to allow any commercial property except industrial convert as of right into housing. So that would have gutted our first floor regulations in downtown. And we wouldn't be having this discussion.
Yeah, would you have to opt in or
could no? There was no opt in. It was going to
pass the Senate. I don't know what the House did.
Yeah, that's why I'm waiting to find out. And I don't think that provision passed the House because it was very late. But it had legs, so the next session that might happen. But what Stephen is describing is basically downtown. What we have now in downtown. What we have. To some degree in Devon, what we have to some degree in Woodmont. And we don't control Route 1. So, you know, we can set the table, but don't fool yourselves. You're not going to have a village setting on Route 1. So the question is, you know, what can you walk to? What can't you walk to? You know, Route 1 is more like a larger boulevard in any sort of big city that happens to have mixed uses along it. It won't be quaint, and that's okay. You know,
we can't change the topography. We can't change
exactly
the skeleton. But
like I said, for the Boston Post Road, it's a long term project.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, I mean, it could be 50 years before it looks much different, but we want to at least set the table. I think I like your term there, Stephen. Is set the table. Let's see who comes to the party. And again, if it's all moot, it's all moot. If new regulations happen, but I think it's, you know, we have an opportunity. I don't know if it's our obligation, but we have an opportunity to try to make it better. And
we can definitely move the needle.
There are a couple of spots on Bridgeport Ave and the Post Road that could be developed rather quickly because there's nothing there right now. You know, I think right up here by Surf Ave and Robert Treat, there's the area that hasn't been touched in at least a decade, you know?
Yeah, there was a dry cleaning establishment there. Got a little bit of soil problem. I've seen the test pits are obvious. I mean, you can clean anything up, but
now I'm gonna rain on your parade. If you're talking about Bridgeport Avenue, the big empty site that's there, that application is coming to you next month. That's going to be the new Bethel site.
If we approve it.
If you approve it.
But there's other properties there on that stretch.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Yeah, totally. Yeah. And that's your CDD zone that right now doesn't allow housing. Yeah. So yeah, it's ripe. That's a ripe zone to add new regulations to it, to allow housing.
So I think that you guys are probably better able to craft some language. If you could put something together for us to review, sure. I'd appreciate that. Is that something we can get the consensus with, to hear their advice on a change to the CDD zones?
For
it. Sure, I'll take a look at it.
So simpler housing regulations in CDD and CD zones.
Yeah, yep. And if it's not 100% mixed use, maybe an option for maybe half the street side or say something that's, it's either commercial or it could be amenity. So if there is a shared office thing that the apartment building offers, or a gym or something. So it's either.
They already allow a wide variety of retail and commercial.
Yeah, I just think that I know that making it 100% commercial hurt Walnut Beach over the years. If you think it's not going to truncate development, one idea is to allow the gym that the apartment, you know, or the pool, if it's big enough, or something that's not actually somebody's bedroom on the street level. They might not do it anyway because they're developers and they know how to build apartments. But
well, you know, we have to deal with the market.
Yeah, we do.
And you know what is the market? What is the state screaming for? Housing. So, you know, giving a developer the choice, hey, this is your list of things, you know, which is what zoning is anyway. This is your list of things. You know, I wouldn't necessarily say that we would have to say, you know, you have to do something mixed. You know, I like the idea of, well, sure, if you do something mixed, maybe there's a carrot to that. But, you know, if we allow them to do housing without commercial, let them do housing without commercial. If they want to have commercial without housing, like some of the zones do now, they can have it. And I would think that, you know, over time that could be fluid and that could change depending on the market.
They would do 100% housing all day, every day, every time.
And
it just makes them more money, David. The rents and the square footage for a group is
and
much
we get,
higher.
And we get more housing. So is so
yeah, I know.
So is that a bad thing or a good thing? I mean, that's what you have to. That's what we all have to figure out.
Depends which side of your fence the fence you're on, because I'm telling you, people are talking. We heard from that group that came last week. They're totally one side of the fence. And then you go and you have a whole other, I would say just as many, if not more people on the other side that say they don't want any more housing in Milford. So, you know, this is a tough situation for us here. I know I go to parties and I see my neighbors walking down the street and they hammer me all day long. Why'd you allow that apartment building? Why'd you allow that? You know, so I think you've got some people that this is not an easy task here.
We all get that for sure. That's why I personally think we should look at the industrial areas as well, because that's removed from those neighborhoods and people won't have to look at that development going up. It's going to be out of sight, out of mind. Yeah, it will fill a need.
I think in regards to the industrial areas, there is still very high demand for industrial space. I don't think we necessarily want to take that off the tax rolls for industrial purposes, taking away and putting it towards multifamily. I think we should instead consider looking at more office-oriented districts where these properties are being underutilized right now. Office demand is not nearly as strong. These are, in many cases, very large lots. You could do something like higher density single family, like houses that people can buy. That's one of the things we're really lacking right now. You're not gonna make a dent unless you build more supply and demand, obviously. But I think the demand there is for single family housing.
The problem there being it's single family housing, and so it's hard to build up that density.
Well, exactly. And when we're talking about these office districts, you're talking about fairly large lots that we could potentially make allowances for subdivision of them for making that single family housing in a higher density.
I think that's a good point, John. I think that's, you know, the co-housing idea that Bob Smith talked about, and smaller houses and little communities. I know we have great opportunity there. And we sort of have to prioritize, but we don't have to put, you know, the back burner is not that far away. If we can get some language, there's no reason to put it off. We could take a look at where are our office districts outside of Bick Drive, Schoolhouse Road. Then there's up there on Wheeler's Farms. We're going to see something coming down the pike for a large office development that's going to look for some residential. Where else is there office districts?
Those are empty up there, Jim, on Wheeler's Farm.
What's that?
Those are empty up there. You're right. Yeah, up on Wheeler's Farms.
Yeah, are there other?
No, you named them because they were deliberately put there because of access to the parkway.
Yeah. Which will still be a good thing for the housing. And there are some models that I've been researching, like co-housing, where you take, doesn't have to be tiny homes in the same way that you see it on the internet, but, you know, smaller homes, closer setbacks with amenities. They have some land trust models where the land is owned by one entity, and then the houses are owned by the individuals. So there's a lot of models that we can look into, you know, how do we set that table? Just make everything open the door and let everything be a special permit, or create, you know, a picture frame around it. But John, I think your instinct is right. There's a great opportunity, and there's more vacant acreage there than probably anywhere else, you know, outside of maybe some of the industrial areas or up on the Housatonic River. But we're just about at our hour now. If we can get some language for the whole board to see, or for the subcommittee to see, what's your instinct, David?
I think I'd want to put together some language for the subcommittee to sort of look at, because I'm going to guess that whatever we come up with, you know, it's going to need, some adjustments of one sort or another. And I think that's what this
committee should be. And it will be. Yeah, oh, yeah. It'll be a special meeting, so everybody will be invited to it.
Yeah, and then okay. and then ultimately
so bring why don't it we to do the... that? It'll be the Wednesday between the next two meetings, two regular meetings.
Yeah, we should chat. If you want these subcommittee meetings to be live on MGAT, we can't do them on this particular sort of night between the two meetings because of two things. On the Tuesday night, which was last night, you have the Zoning Board of Appeals, and on the Wednesday night, tonight, is the Inland Wetlands Commission. So that's so MGAT, they notified me for this meeting. They said, hey, Dave, you know, please record it so then they can post it up. So if you don't mind it being posted after the fact, that's fine.
Yeah, I think that's fine.
Okay.
Unless anyone else has a need for it to be live. All right, let's do Wednesday between the next two meetings, and it'll be, you know, either a special meeting for the whole group if everyone wants to show up. If not, we'll switch it last minute to a subcommittee, and we'll see language to discuss, and we will then take a deeper dive on the office district, where you can update us if you're allowed to on a potential application coming down the pike.
Yep.
So that we'll know someone's coming in with an application to do a zone change for a specific site, and we may be able to piggyback our wish list onto that zone change, even if it doesn't affect that particular application. Right. And then, yeah, that's okay with me, unless anyone else has anything they want to add in. What is this 632, David? I'm not aware of it.
Oh, so we can discuss that the next meeting. We need to tweak our 632. The city attorney would like us to add, and Stephen can chime in, it's literally like one or two words to just clarify it having to do with expanding non-conforming structures. We've been interpreting it a particular way, which we believe is correct, and the city attorney has no issue with, but the thinking is it would be better just to clarify it with a few extra words. Stephen, do you want to say anything about that?
Yeah, the suggested language is crystal clear. It leaves no doubt, no room for argument as to what's an expansion of a nonconformity.
All right. Well, yeah, we'll take that up next. If you would, make sure we all see existing language and new language before the meeting.
Yep.
Okay. Anyone else have anything before we call it a night?
Do you want to approve the minutes from 3/13/24?
Do we have a motion?
I motion.
Without objection. So moved. Thanks, everybody, for your time.
Thanks.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Have a good night, everyone.